Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Kiev, home of Star Ladder Season 8. Over 130,000 US dollars to be handed out over the course of this event. I'm LD. Of course, I'm joined here by Merlini of Beyond the Summit. And guys, we're getting set now for our first match. Winner's bracket, double elimination. This is going to be our first of two games today, Ben. It will be Alliance versus Fnatic. Two teams that have played each other quite a lot.
They are regular scrimmage buddies. And
very good friends.
Yeah, the games are... I don't know. It seems like the games are actually very... Like, every time I watch them two play, it's like somewhat of the same thing. I hope we see something exciting. But yeah, familiar faces, familiar teams.
Yeah, I mean, we know how these teams like to play, right? Fnatic, they love to put Hani on the Invoker, Queen of Pain, Storm, these snowball solo mids that can just take over a game. They run a lot of Tiny Wisp in the past. That's kind of been their go-to. Sometimes we'll see No-Tail on those really aggressive junglers, go for some, you know, early tower pushes. And that's something a lot of teams have been harping upon. We saw a lot of that discussion in the pregame interviews was the importance of getting those early towers in your safe lane.
It surely is. I wonder if we're going to see like an early Enchantress coming out from Fnatic. I think Alliance and Na'Vi, maybe. I think one of those teams like always ban Enchantress versus them just because of how good certain teams are with it here. I think Na'Vi is also really good with Enchantress.
Yeah, both of these teams had a solid group stage. Alliance a little bit stronger in terms of their results. And if you look at all four teams at this event, in terms of their overall win rate in 6.79, Alliance actually has the highest win rate. But where they haven't delivered is in the most important matches, the LAN finals, the championship matches. Since 6.79 came out, that's where they've been falling short.
Win rate's a garbage stat. Because, like, you play, like, in Star Ladder, there's a lot of...
I agree. It only tells a piece of the
You need strength
puzzle.
Of schedule, too. Yeah. If it were, like, the NFL, where it's, like...
Well, everyone plays the same teams. There is no strength of schedule in Star Ladder.
Oh, I thought you were talking about win rate in 6.79.
Oh, yeah, that is true in 6.79.
Yeah, it's garbage stat. Don't like it. Don't like
I'm
it.
I'm trying to defend Star Ladder here. They were kind enough to fly us out. And
oh, no.
You're calling it garbage.
I think it's a good stat if it's in Star Ladder. I thought you were talking about overall.
Yeah, this is only for Star Ladder.
Okay. Yeah.
But yeah, overall, across the board, they do have the best win rate. But like you said, it only means so much. But coming into this match, Alliance has started to evolve a bit. They've moved Loda into the drafting role for the team.
I wonder if they change like where they sit to.
Actually, can we... Loda's...
Loda's on the end.
He's on the end.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know who's making the in-game calls. Is it still S4? I know Loda makes some as the game goes later.
I think S4 is still in the middle, so probably.
In theory.
Yeah.
I know they said in the past when the games go later, like everyone... I mean, obviously every team, all players have input, but...
It's really hard for the carry player to make the calls in the game, though.
Like, yeah.
Especially if you're in a try-on-try, you cannot concentrate on
Not
what's going
on in the laning stage.
Yeah.
Like, late game, I think it's less of an issue.
But I think... I mean, it's more important to have those... decision-making in the first 15 minutes, I think, though. Because in the late game, everyone's, like, pretty much on the same page. Hey, let's defend Roshan, let's push towers. But, like, in the early game, it's...
Get Rex, kill the enemy throne, defend your own ancient.
Win money.
It all seems so simple.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Play but. Dota.
Hala hala, get Dala. But there's a lot of prize money at stake in this tournament. Over 130,000, and that's thanks to you guys in the community. We've seen a huge outpouring of support, buying the bundle, buying the courier, as well as just buying the tickets directly. And just like MLG, it's been amazing to see the community support. And, you know, what I'm really curious to see is I imagine we'll see more tournaments having this moving forward. And are people going to continue to buy into it? Will we see compendiums for these events? Maybe?
I think it's cool. Like, the pennant idea didn't really seem to work out that well.
Yeah, and Valve even said that's where they came back with the compendium, because the pennants was like they wanted people to have a way to support teams, but people didn't really get enough for it.
Yeah.
But with stuff like compendiums and, you know, bundles, item sets, you get more bang for your buck.
If you could have like the pennant on the courier or something,
ooh,
then that would be awesome, right? But like you no one can see your pennant or you can't show off who you support, which is eh.
Who are you supporting? I was frantically trying to put my rares on Fnatic for this match because those odds are amazing.
Like, yeah,
I don't think
good.
It's a 33
it's good value
match. I would maybe say Alliance a tiny advantage, but
historically, I think Fnatic has taken.
Yeah, historically, Fnatic I think beats Alliance. Actually, I don't know the overall win rate, but just the games I've watched, they generally seem to get the best of them.
So the last time they were on LAN together, I think was EMS. I mean, minus the stand-in.
Yeah, and Fnatic obviously got the best of them.
Right, so. I'd say...
And they've been performing better in general lately.
Yeah, I would say actually Fnatic should be, like, maybe a slight favorite. Barely.
Now, of course, with Alliance, there's always, like, kind of that, not quite Navi level, but sort of that mystique where they might be having a bad run, but this is a world-class team that's won the international, right? They've won. They went to China. They came, they saw, they conquered. They took the G1 LAN finals by storm, didn't drop a game there, and almost went in all of TI3 without dropping a game. So
that's a long time ago, though. Things have changed.
Ancient history of Dota years.
Yeah.
But, well, they've got a grizzly veteran here in Loda who will be sure to remind us of their track record so far. Mm.
I wonder how his drafting skills are.
Have you been impressed by his drafting so far? I mean, he's been doing some different stuff, which is obviously, I think, change is good. If what you're doing ain't working, you got to change it, right?
I'm not sure. To be honest, I haven't seen it.
Okay. Well, we're going to find out soon. They have run some kind of standard Alliance drafts.
Mm-hmm.
We've seen them try to incorporate Slark occasionally. The Naga comes into play once in a while. But, I mean, we still see a lot of Ake's jungling supports. Bulldog. We still see the Prophet in the mix. The Lone Druid seems not to be as popular for Alliance.
They've never run Pugna, so like Pugna plus Lone Druid near towers are just owned. They also don't use Death Prophet very often.
It always seems when I'm casting this team like they just really want S4 on a tempo controller. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like LGD with Xiao 8 where, you know, they want him on a Beastmaster, a Magnus, a Puck. It's obviously S4 can,
well, you
play
can
play the other
you
heroes.
Can play like a carry Pugna too.
Yeah.
Havos played Pugna.
If you go late game enough and you have Ag Scepter, Scythe, BKB, very hard to kill, and you do a lot of damage.
I think Pugna, you can't just throw into any strategy, though. He's really good for certain heroes, like Lion, he just destroys. Same with Shadow Shaman.
Yeah.
And he's really good in tandem with Death Prophet, Lone Druid. I think Nature's Prophet he's like okay with, but they don't really seem to have a concentrated strat. And that's like one of the easiest strats to run. I'm surprised they haven't gone that route.
Yeah, it's something we even saw. I mean, it's really popular in Asia right now. Running like a Dragon Knight mid, getting your Pugna as another, like a safe lane farmer, or even go aggressive tri lane. DK has done that before.
What do you think these two teams are going to rely on in terms of strategy? Is Fnatic and Alliance just going to do their normal same stuff?
For me, I think Wisp is a must ban unless one of the teams plans on like picking it really early in the draft, especially for Alliance. I feel like they cannot give Wisp away to Fnatic because Fnatic is just too good at that hero. If they do give it away, they really need to have a game plan for how to counter it. And, well, it's always easier said than done with Wisp.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, yeah, we'll have really good map awareness, guys. Like, and then shit happens and you forget. And Tiny's wrecking your face.
You can't hear the thing sometimes, the relocate.
Yeah, if there's a lot of other noise going on. Like, you don't get the audio notification, and you can't constantly stare at the minimap. You look away for half a second, they're on top of you. It's tough. So, I mean, for me, I think getting Wisp out of the pool is pretty important. Mm-hmm. And then from there, I would say, don't let Hani get out of control. If you're Alliance, that's the key to the game for me, is try and deny the Wisp if possible, and keep Hani down.
Because I think it's the same for
Fnatic. He's such a snowball player.
They need to keep S4 down, too.
Who do you think is going to be harder to keep down, then, I guess, is the question.
I think there's more early game roaming from Fnatic than Alliance, so I think that Hani will be harder to keep down. I think S4 is a slightly stronger mid in terms of mid game decisions, but early game I'd say they're about equal. So it really comes down to supports and how they play. They also tend to draft more for S4. I think like S4 tends to get like slightly more lane dominant heroes. I'd say like Invoker, he's not a lane dominator at all, but they always draft him for Hani.
Yeah, Hani finds a way, though. I mean, you got to give him credit. Like, he really maximizes his efficiency with the Invoker. You know, using Ford Spirits to check runes, deny them, pull the creep way back so you can push with the other Ford Spirit your hero. He's definitely mastered it. And, well, Boots of Travel are one of Hani's go-to items. I imagine we may see them in this series. But, guys, for those who are wondering, we did load into the game, but there are some mic issues for, I believe it was Fnatic. So we are going to have a quick remake here, but we should be getting underway soon. This is going to be a best of three. The loser not eliminated, but done for today. Both teams are actually done for today. Two best of threes today. Tomorrow, I believe, we'll have our first team that gets knocked out of the tournament. But you drop down here, you've got to win two loser bracket games just to get yourself back into the grand finals. That's pretty tough.
All teams are guaranteed money, though. I think it's around 12,000 for last place, 18,000 for third place, too. So pretty good prize, even if you don't go home with a big victory.
Are we remaking? Because
I'm not sure.
I see a lot of people disconnecting, but not a new lobby yet. I imagine we're going to remake here, guys, but we'll stay tuned to let you know. Predictions, Ben.
Who do you think? For this match?
Like, I think it's a good bet to bet on Fnatic, but that's because the odds are so slated against them, and I think it's
very... I would actually say they're, like, slight favorites.
I'd say, like, 55-45 Fnatic for me.
Yeah. Mine's a little bit closer to 50-50, but I...
53-47?
Yeah.
Lobby's up, by the way. But if the odds were really close, I don't know if I could pick a team. A lot of it just comes down to the drafts. Like, is Fnatic going to get Wisp? Is Alliance going to get a draft that they're comfortable with? And what is even comfortable for them now? Like, Bulldog Longer, they don't go to that anymore. He's still playing a lot of Prophet. Occasionally, like, a Clockwork offlane.
Bounty Hunter, what happened to that hero?
We've seen him try to play some Timbersaw, but it's not really his forte.
Elder Titan.
Yeah, and the Elder Titan as well. It's just not...
I want to see more Bounty Hunter, though. I'm surprised they haven't used it that often.
You remember when this patch first came out? Bounty Hunter was, like, the hero.
He's good.
And then he fell off a lot.
Yeah.
Well, how do you explain that? Because the hero hasn't been changed. Not recently. I mean, the track used to have that armor debuff. Doesn't anymore, but that was a while ago.
I think that the supports have been playing, like, a lot more greedier recently. Mm-hmm. Like, Crystal Maiden just jungles very, very early, and the supports aren't as easy to kill because of that. And they have more items and more gold to deal with them.
Teams are good at dealing with Bounty Hunter now. Like, you'll always see the supports buy sentries and start with Dust. Like, they come prepared.
Yeah. It's important to keep them down early, though. Can't have them getting solo kills in the lane.
Yeah, I remember it must have been like a year ago. I was casting G League with Winter, and Ice was playing offlane Bounty Hunter, and he bought his own wards, and he warded a couple camps just to force them to use sentries to deward. So they didn't have sentries for the lane. But this was before teams bought Dust for Bounty Hunter. Like, it wasn't that common 9 months, a year ago. Like, at level one, you didn't start with Dust that often. So, but nowadays, teams buy Dust and sentries, so harder for Bounty Hunter to get in the lane. Mm. And I guess the other thing is we see a lot of solos that are really good in 1v1, like Timbersaw, Clockwork. If they have sentries or Dust, they can just crush a Bounty Hunter.
Lundruid
as well. Bulldog Lundruid is always just something Alliance could throw in, and if you don't have the right lanes to deal with it, that could just be game.
He does okay. Bounty Hunter does like okay versus like Nature's Prophet, I think, and a couple of other ones. Nature's Prophet's a little bit weak in lane.
Yeah. Even if you sick the Treants online, Bounty Hunter's got like 6 base armor.
Fnatic sounds like they're prepared, but are they prepared for Lotus draft? It seems like they were very well prepared for S4 and what he drafted for the team. But is Lota going to bring a new and...
A Tuskar! Do we see a Tuskar here? Little Walrus Punch action.
Is it Tuskar? I thought it was Tusk. They call him Tusk.
Tusk.
Gosh. They're going to change his name too.
Windranger, Tusk.
I'm not a fan of Windranger. That's probably like my least favorite change.
I range with the wind!
Necrophos. Necrophos I can deal with, I suppose.
Yeah.
You can just call him Necro, right? I guess you can still call Windrunner WR. Anyways. So do you think Lota's going to bring something new? Do you think Fnatic's going to be caught off guard by anything?
I do think he'll bring something new, but I don't have any idea what it is. Alliance got here pretty late relative to the other teams. Na'Vi was the last team in, but Fnatic, I do want to mention, they were here at 9 a.m. local time, which is like 8 a.m. their time from Sweden. So they got here really freaking early, and we're just like playing games all morning long. So
not hanging out at Mr. Cat?
No. Alliance loves that pizza place, by the way. I like it too. I mean, we got a meal for like 8 people for, what was it, $100?
And?
No, not, sorry, not $100. It was like, and a lot of drinks.
Yeah.
A few drinks.
Mr. Cat, legendary restaurant if you guys ever visit Kiev.
Right across the street. Don't actually run across the street if you are here at the Star Arena. Cyber Arena, go under. There's an underpass. But yeah, I mean, Alliance just showed up late, so it's like a very different approach, right? Fnatic comes really early. They're practicing, getting comfortable all morning, and you know, I'm sure you've had this experience. You go to a new land, like you want to get your mouse settings just right.
Getting in the zone.
If you're flash, you bring a tape measure and you start, you know, drawing on the table to make sure everything's just so. But
you also got to get like used to the environment.
They kind of YOLO'd it. They've been here before, so too is Fnatic. But it's just interesting to see kind of that divergence. Anything else that's percolating through your brain?
Checking out the venue.
We're still waiting for the game to start, guys, by the way. As you can probably tell.
A lot of camera people. A couple interviews being...
It's not that full yet, but considering this is day one, like, I remember for MLG, it was granted a much significantly bigger in terms of the number of seats they had, but day one, it was, like, not that full at all. And then day two and three, it got really full, and already there's quite a sizable crowd here. So I don't know if you guys can really see them. A lot of people, like, over this way, but...
Well, also on the first day of MLG, it's like the group stage matches, right? And those aren't as exciting as
this format. It's like bracket. You go right into the most meaningful matches.
Mm. We've already had a couple months of regular season.
I like how like the regular season does feel, I wouldn't say grueling, but a little bit longer at times.
It's very long.
Round robin, 16 teams. That's a lot of games. But then you get here, and it's every match is not quite do or die, but it makes all the difference. And guys, with that being said, I think we're ready. It's time for our first match. Alliance versus Fnatic. This is a best of three. Winner advances into the winner bracket finals. Guaranteed top three and guaranteed a bit more money. Loser, not out, but they will drop down. We'll see the loser tomorrow. With that being said, Ben, draft is...
Get pumped.
Get hype?
Get pumped.
Yeah. Vlad's not hyping up the crowd yet. That'll come later.
What does he actually do? To hype up the crowd.
I don't know. I've never been here before. We're going to find out soon, though.
I know.
Oi, oi, oi.
Vlad's a fun guy.
Yeah. He's a really fun guy. Too much fun. It's dangerous going out with him.
He's also really nice and courteous to us, too. Yes. The Ukrainian people are very courteous.
He saved our bags. We had no luggage. We were going to be wearing, like, sweatpants and hoodies. The same sweatpants and hoodies the entire event because Air France screwed the pooch. But based Vlad bailed us out.
Thanks, Vlad.
Thanks, Vlad. And thanks for bringing us here. We're very excited to be here, guys. Should be hopping to the draft momentarily. And, I mean, so far, it looks fairly standard. I think the interesting thing here is there's no Alchemist ban yet. Has to be coming.
Fnatic was talking about how ridiculous that hero is, though, when I was talking to them back at a D2L finals. So,
yeah.
I don't think they'll let it. Oh, they actually did let it through.
Well, wow.
Well, the thing about it is that they... Also, one thing that I heard them say is that they don't think that Alliance utilizes the hero very well.
They don't run that much support out. Like, they never run it solo mid, for one thing. And I don't think...
What, Alliance?
I haven't seen them ever.
Oh, S4 plays it. He's played the mid a couple of times.
I haven't seen... It's not, like, a common thing for them, at least, that I've seen.
They said they don't utilize them very well, though. I've seen them play it a couple of times. But, wow. So, Alliance took the Wisp.
Yeah, I mean, I thought it would be a key hero in this series, but I figured it might be Fnatic who go for it. Now, I will say, Fnatic is probably one of the teams I think is most confident against Wisp. Like, not only do they run it really well, but they feel very confident about punishing a Wisp pick. And
yeah, that's the thing. When you run a hero a lot, you know exactly how to play versus it.
Yeah, because you have those frustrating moments of games where you're like, this is ridiculous. I can't deal with this. And then next time you play against him, you look, Alchemist, Timbersaw, very bursty heroes, lots of lockdown, and just heroes they can just instantly kill with.
That's a really good opener from Fnatic, though. This is probably one of the best openers that they're going to get, I'd say. EO and Enchantress, if they get hit by Unstable Concoction, they're going to be at like half HP.
Instantly. And Timbersaw is going to shred them as well.
Yeah.
And Wisp being a strength hero is doing her no favors there either.
It's going to be very important for the supports on Fnatic to get their job done early, though. If they let Alliance play passively, or if Fnatic plays passively and lets Alliance farm up and get levels, I think Alliance will beat them out, at least in the mid-game. So Fnatic needs to bring the fight to them early. We might see the classic CM Alchemist. Oh, actually, CM Alchemist has been removed. Crystal Maiden Alchemist, I think, is considered one of the strongest roaming duos in the game right now.
Yeah, it might be, like, the best support opening in this patch, or definitely one of, like, the top five combos, because the CM can jungle from level one. They're both really strong at roaming. The Alk scares really well with farm. They've got a lot of lockdown, a lot of kill power. Like, they can pretty much do anything.
Yeah, that's the thing about this patch. It's you want to pick the heroes with most versatility. Alchemist, probably the most versatile hero.
Prophet's a great example.
Yeah, Prophet too. And Crystal Maiden, you can roam, you can babysit, you can jungle too. And not that many supports can do that.
So as far as Fnatic's draft goes, I mean, it was just the first two bans, but they did seem to target Bulldog here a bit. They banned the Prophet, they banned the Clockwork, and they took the Timbersaw. For Bulldog at this point, generally I would say like it's Bounty Hunter or Lone Druid are his more likely picks. We've seen some Elder Titan from him. It's been hit or miss. I don't think you can necessarily go for it now because then you have three heroes that really have no stuns at all against Timbersaw. That's going to be tough.
Just need damage, man.
Get so much deep, so just one-shot everyone.
Well, I'm not really sure what Alliance is going to use as their... duo for EO though. If they do CK, like Alchemist and Timbersaw already have so much AoE that his images aren't going to be very useful, and he's not going to do that much damage versus Timbersaw anyway, since all his damage is physical damage based.
The big ones we've seen a lot in the past from Alliance are, well, I'd say Phantom Assassin, they really favored, but that was against physical damage carries, like to counter Lifestealer, to counter Lone Druid perhaps.
Yeah, he'll get, PA should get wrecked against
just all this magic damage.
Right.
You can't evade that. The other one that we've seen occasionally is Riki. And, of course, Tiny is, like, the most common carry pick to go with Wisp in this patch. Because unlike CK, he can keep up and farm, where CK can struggle a lot in that department.
Yeah, CK can't play the farm war, really. I mean, you can, but
you can, like, Midas and try to, but it's a losing proposition. And now Alliance will ban out the Bane. One other hero that's been ignored, that we've been talking about a lot is Mirana. Mirana's still sitting out there.
Mm-hmm.
Not something that Alliance really runs.
They run it sometimes.
Not that common.
Yeah, it doesn't apply enough pressure early.
Like, if Sigma was in this game, I'd say like they're definitely taking the Mirana. And Na'Vi plays it quite a bit, too. But I feel it's not as much of a popular pick for these two teams.
Fnatic bans out the Puck. Puck, I think, is probably the only hero that can get away from the unstable concoction. I guess Lifesteal. Lifesteal still takes damage when you rage, though. So, looks like they want to get a lot of work done with the Alchemist early.
What a hero.
What a hero.
Seriously.
Alchemist, I mean, I thought he got nerfed last patch. I was like, oh, it kind of looks like a nerf. Or I was like, okay, Ice Frog knows that this hero is overpowered.
He's trying to nerf him.
And then you look at his ultimate, and he's like, wait, this guy doesn't die as a support.
Yeah, you need, like, a Timber Saw and then, like, an OD to, like, burst him instantly, or else you're just going to lose the fight.
Mm-hmm.
And he just does so much damage. That's the big problem. Like, the stun and Acid Spray just... And you can Roshar. God, he's a good hero.
Yeah. And the thing about it, they're like easy spells to get off to. You have like a, 7-second window for concoction.
Yeah.
You have...
And Dota 1, if the timer runs out when it's traveling, it just explodes midair. But in Dota 2, it just...
Ooh,
as long as you launch at a time, it just follows you all the way.
A Slark pick.
And no Miguel in this game. So who's going to be playing it is the big
question. It's going to be a carry Slark.
You think it's a one position?
I don't think it's not going to be a mid Slark. Hani does not play Slark. It's not a Hani hero.
I mean, it could be a Trixie like offlane, and then they run Alk support, but that's...
And Timber mid?
Yeah, maybe. It's not really...
That's also not a Hani hero,
He plays it occasionally, but I've seen him play it occasionally, but yeah, it's definitely not like a go-to hero for him.
Yeah.
And seems like our custom draft screen has a few kinks to work out here, but looks pretty cool. Apparently the draft hasn't started yet.
You can see the teams debating. See No-Tail helping out there. All don't have their hands on their faces, though.
They look pensive. Everyone's rubbing their face now.
Mm-hmm. Slark doesn't really have any debuffs to get rid of yet. I'm surprised they took him right now. He's, like, really good versus someone like Nyx Assassin. Ooh, the Viper pick from Alliance. You guys can't actually see the draft, but the next pickup by Alliance is Viper, so we could just see a... Mass heal for Viper. I've seen that strat before. Like Abaddon
just
Viper.
Build your unkillable Viper with like tree armor, yeah. Aphotic shield, stuff like that.
It's okay. The only thing about it, he doesn't do that much damage unless you focus him.
Yeah.
Right? Like if you leave him alone in a fight, it's like, well, he's annoying, but we'll get through it because we'll kill everybody else.
And he does damage very slowly compared to like other carries, like OD, Lifestealer. I mean, pretty much any carry does more burst than him. Gyro, another good example.
If you can just like avoid him, especially with like an OD or something like that, you just astral him and then just worry about him later.
And this team is good at avoiding people. Slark's very elusive. Timbersaw is extremely elusive. Mm-hmm. And Viper also does not have a stun. So you can still Timber Chain away. Won't be interrupted. They actually still have zero stuns. And now the Hani Invoker comes out.
I must favor Fnatic's draft. Like, even from the first two picks, the Alchemist and the Timbersaw, I think that it was already pretty strong. And then looking at the Viper pick from Alliance, it's lackluster.
Nuclear launch detected. I'm hoping for some big Hani Sunstrikes here. He had some amazing ones at D2L, which you were casting.
Mm-hmm.
Very impressive. But he had the... What was it like? I think it was on the Radiant side shop. He just blindly sunstrikes somebody. Didn't actually know. Just like he's gonna juke there, nails it. But we'll have to see if he delivers here. And obviously, this is just more burst damage for Fnatic. Very bursty lineup against two very squishy supports, Enchantress and Wisp.
They have much better gank than Alliance too. Like Alliance, if Enchantress ganks a lane, it's still difficult to get a kill, especially on Slark or Timbersaw.
Look at this.
EO can't really do that much early. Ooh, the Tusk ban.
I just noticed that right now. My goodness.
Maybe they were scared of the Wisp Inch.
That Wisp Enchantress. This shows that, I mean, Fnatic has done their homework. Because that tri lane just... Was it Vici that they were playing or LGD?
I think it was Vici.
They wrecked.
It was Styler.
That tri lane was brutal. And a support that fucking Mad was saying has... or even a solo mid, potentially. A hero that's really kind of risen to prominence lately is Shadow Shaman. You mentioned the potential to Roche very early by war-trapping him.
Mm-hmm.
Also a very strong pushing hero. But another squishy, fairly immobile hero against a team full of burst damage and lockdown.
He's very bad versus Slark, too. Like, Slark will just Dark Pack and just kill Shadow Shaman, like, every time they're in a fight. So, Alliance's lineup, I don't really know how they're going to stand up versus damage output from Fnatic.
It seems like they might be leaning towards a kind of rounding out with some more push here. Viper, Shadow Shaman, Enchantress, pretty heavy on the push. Do you think they go, not all in, but for another strong pushing hero? Or if not, what do you go for? Is it... I guess the big question is, what's Bulldog going to play?
They could like Pugna push, but I mean, Lone Druid push, it's, you know, it's so-so.
Fnatic actually banned Chaos Knight, and I guess it's going to be just a Viper Wisp partner or pairing, because I feel like it's got to be a Bulldog hero now, right?
I believe so.
Bounty Hunter? Not that great against Slark.
Fnatic rounds their lineup up. Lifestealer, he's okay here.
Good against a lot of these Fnatic heroes. You did mention there's still a lot of physical damage, though. There's the Acid Spray.
There's a lot of physical damage.
Yeah, Acid Spray minus armor, the Unstable Concoction, and the Venge.
And Force Spirit.
And the right click from Invoker. This is going to hurt. I mean, even with Rage.
Force Spirit, too.
Yeah. Yeah, Force Spirits as well. Well, with that being said, Merlini, it's time for game one of our first best of three, Alliance versus Team Fnatic. And let me just quickly fix my camera settings here. Looks like they did not save. Okay, here we go. On the Dire side, we have the Alliance, the Swedes. Ake going to be playing the Enchantress. EGM, the EO. Admiral Bulldog handling the Viper. You can hear the crowd giving it up for both teams. Loda on the Lifestealer. S4 going to be playing that Shadow Shaman. And that does round out the Alliance. And then on the Radiant side, we have Team Fnatic.
Yeah, it looks like they're all five headed to the woods right now. We see Era in front on the Slark. We see No-Tail closely behind him on the Alchemist. See Trixie on the Timbersaw. Honey on his signature Invoker. And Fly on the support Ventral Spirit.
So both teams going defensive off the bat here. Nobody really looking to contest the enemy jungle. Alliance are running some fairly aggressive heroes like Enchantress, Lifestealer. You see these, there's the option to go aggressive tri-lane early on. A Wisp isn't normally the strongest aggressive tri-laner, but with an Enchantress Lifesteal, that can be dangerous. But for now, seems like Alliance is not going to contest. They are sending Loda off lane. And remember, Loda is the one doing the drafting now for this team. But what do you make of the lane so far? Should Alliance just be going defensive here?
Since they don't have a good offlane hero, yes, I think so.
You don't think Lifestealer with like Enchantress backing up is enough there?
In the offlane?
Yeah.
It's okay. It's okay. It's not going to stand up versus a tri-lane, though.
And Fnatic have a very scary tri-lane, especially mainly because they have Alchemist.
Like, Alchemist, he's already like, smoked, too.
He's like the new Visage in a way, it feels. Just the hero that just wins the laning stage for you.
Yeah, they're going to put a lot of pressure, it looks like, on Bulldog as well as Aki early. They can kill Aki, especially since he won't have his heal at level 1. We need to see where he's going to go. They might actually be going on S4.
Wrapping around the stun now being channeled. This could be pain time for S4. Great positioning, but just not great enough against that Unstable Concoction. It will fly. There's the stun. Follow-up comes from Fly. Perfect chain stun. First blood will go to Fnatic. And the crowd goes fairly wild. Pretty enthusiastic bunch this early on.
Yeah, they're really capitalizing on the weak early game of Alliance. And they're doing exactly what they should be doing in their early game, getting kills with their very aggressive Alchemist and Ventral Spear, probably two of the best level 1 heroes in the game.
Straight to the top lane they go. They've already clarityed up on Fly. He did get off a healing salve, and they did juggle the tower aggro nicely there. So that he was able to salve up, and now they head straight towards Bulldog, playing a safe lane Viper. Really not a hero that we're accustomed to seeing him on, and he could be in trouble here. He backs off for now, and the wave will push, but they could also go hunting for Ake. With the burst damage they have, any one hero they catch will probably die. And meanwhile, you look at Alliance's offlane.
There's a smoke from Ake.
Alliance's Ake will smoke up, but Alliance's offlane, they can't kill Era. Like, they can't punish any of these heroes right now, it feels. Maybe Hani. Hani's probably the one they could gank. And yeah, it looks like that will be the play.
S4 has Shackle up, but, I mean, are you really going to be able to, like, walk up and shackle him?
Top lane. Bulldog's been caught out of position. A few stuns. One more right click. Down he goes. Fnatic are on a roll. 2-0. Less than 2 minutes in, and now it's Ake's turn. Can he strike back? Going on the Slark, this is the hardest hero to gank. If they're going for him.
Arrow actually pounced into him.
He's feeling very confident here. And he does have that early point in Dark Pack, so can debuff all these stuns. And in fact, Ake's going to be spotted here. Great Observer Ward from Fnatic. They will dive Era now. He has no leap. He Dark Packs off the slow, but he's taking a lot of damage. Could salve up. Looks to be dead. Salving, juking through the trees, but the stun finds a beautiful play from Ake. 2-1.
That was just a big misplay from Era, though, earlier. He didn't have his pounce up. When
used it offensively.
Yeah, he used it offensively, and he actually missed, too. So I'm not really sure what he's trying to accomplish in a 1v2 scenario, but he should not be using his pounce in an offensive situation like that, especially when there is a threat of an Enchantress coming around.
We do have a quick pause here, guys. It appears that Trixie doesn't have sound.
I don't have sound either.
Yeah, I don't have sound either. Hopefully the stream does. Mm. But it's going well for Fnatic. Pick Alk, have a good time.
Yeah, it's really on the support though in the early game. We see Aki already pick up one kill, and No-Tail and Fly Duo already picking up two. So we're talking about 2 minutes into the game. And this is kind of how you expect the game to go, because Fnatic is trying to keep Wisp under-leveled and take advantage of Shadow Shaman's extremely weak early game. He has one armor, too, so he's just going to just get wrecked by Concoction.
Yeah, and we'll have to see how he fits into the picture later on. It was interesting because they went for the Shadow Shaman, and they already had Enchantress and Viper. And Viper can kind of be that
greedy of a lineup, I'd say.
That like tanky frontline hero. And then they went back for Lifestealer, who doesn't really push that early. His laning presence is not what it used to be. I mean, back when Open Wounds actually had a range to it, you could initiate force fights and go for a lot of kills. They did get that one kill bottom, but if Shadow Shaman gets shut down early mid, I mean, he's useless later on.
Yeah, and Hani likes to go Orchid a lot on Invoker. If you just silence your biggest threat, whether it be Shadow Shaman or Lifestealer, they're going to be in for a lot of trouble.
And we are back into it, guys. Now it's Fnatic's turn to make their third move of the game, 2-for-2, looking to make it 3-for-3, as Era will TP back bottom. And they wrap around on Bulldog here, who's just not been given much space so far this game. Under duress from the Timbersaw, he is 10-4, CSing well, but constantly has to worry about these ganks. And the reason is, Ben, he has zero vision in his jungle. He has no idea where these supports are. In fact, they don't even have a ward towards the top.
Era's actually going to chase Aki. He knows that he's creeping this camp right now, and he's going to find him. Is there going to be a Sunstrike or something to help out?
There is a heal available here. At the same time, the leap comes through to get a lot of damage. Juking as much as he can. The essence shift starting to work, but it's not enough to get the kill. Meanwhile, middle lane, they dive S4. They'll get the Shadow Shaman again. Punished by Fnatic. Loda does TP in and looks for the turnaround here as Fly retreats out. And Fly, Ford Spirit coming in, look for the body block, nothing yet. I think should be okay. Nice ice wall. Hani gets him out of jail.
Great awareness by Fly there. He was initially going to run down straight into Aki, notices him with the ward, and then runs left. And now they force Loda away from the lane. So Alliance is scrambling to win their lanes right now. I think everyone has taken a hit. We've seen S4 die twice. We've seen Admiral Bulldog die once on top and on the bottom lane. Loda isn't like exactly free farm, and he has to use a TP too. So if he's going for early Midas, it's not going to come out from like the 5 minute mark like we sometimes see.
As strong as Shadow Shaman is offensively, he is very weak defensively compared to a lot of the other solo mids we see, like Puck, Timbersaw, Dragonite, tanky heroes, elusive heroes. Shadow Shaman is neither of these things, and just Fnatic really exploiting the weak. This
Fly with the Invis rune, he scouts out S4. He's looking for backup, but Alchemist is nowhere to be found.
Oh, this could have been an opportunity, but with two here, and S4 now picking up his bottle, tough dive for him. And we will see just Fnatic kind of content to go back to jungling. They've had that aggression. They got the boots up on No-Tail. Actually, this is going to be another kill mid. S4 caught out of position. The stun comes through. A few more right clicks will bring him down. Another death for the Shadow Shaman. And Hani's out of control. 3-0-0.
No charging up a stun.
Yeah, Loda could be caught out here. He will rage dodge the stun. Still takes the damage, but can retreat out.
I think one big part of Alliance's early game is that they actually had very poor wards at the start. They had a ward down here, but there was almost, they didn't even touch bottom at all. The two supports from Fnatic, at least not until recently.
Yeah, and meanwhile, top lane, Bulldog trying to find Trixie, or is he being caught out here? The Timber Chain coming through, as well as the Chakram. The Timber Chain off the mark, but he's got another one, jams it in, gets the kill. Fnatic's on fire, make it 5-1.
I'm surprised he didn't just like run up over here. If he runs up over here and straight in the middle of the lane, he can't actually get hit by a...
Oh, they're not done yet. They go into S4, another kill on the Shadow Shaman. 6-1, just
this
brutal.
This is getting ugly.
I mean, 33-67 did feel very not representative of the matchup to me, but Fnatic, give them credit. They're coming out swinging. And I mean, you mentioned the warding, but I do feel a lot of this is just coming down to the way Alliance drafted. Their heroes are just not the strongest in lane, and they can't punish a hero like Slark or Timbersaw.
But with the draft, you know exactly what Fnatic's going to do.
Yeah.
And they just roam around early, get a ton of kills, and their wards did not set up appropriately. Like, why would they gank a Lifestealer when there's a Shadow Shaman in mid?
And you mentioned it. Fnatic are the team of these two that likes to roam more. You see the draft. You know
they're
style.
Smoked up again. They're looking for another kill.
I think, fortunately for Alliance, this is their last smoke. I believe that is the third. It might be the second. They have one more in reserve, so they still have another smoke available. Well, one will fail, but Now it's Alliance's turn to smoke. They're trying to make a go here. They do find Fly in the river, but they're going to have to dive him. Open Wounds comes through. Tether is available. It was actually used on S4. They're also trying to focus the Invoker. Fly's low. Fly will fall. Alliance striking back here, but now S4 in trouble on the run. Still alive. Era retreating to the south. He has no leap. He's got stick charges. Trying to wait for the last possible second. Pops it now. Has the leap. Trying to run. Can't get out. He'll go down. 6-3. Alliance striking back.
Wisp did a really good job of keeping up the S4 there. He was getting focused pretty hard by Slark as well as Invoker, but did not drop at all.
That early value point at overcharge making a big difference.
Yeah, it's really good. You need to be able to take damage too so that you can actually heal people up.
You know, it used to be we'd see players skip it, but ever since the change to Tether where it no longer stuns, this definitely seems like the stronger build.
Well, they also fix it so that if you're at full HP and full mana, you don't grant regeneration to your ally.
Right,
so
right.
So you have to be not at 100%.
So then you have to like damage yourself in order to heal your teammate. And we will see Loda now aggressively farming the enemy jungle. Alliance, they've just not abandoned... Oh, we'll have a little lag skip there. Nothing too serious, though. They kind of abandoned this offlane, though. They're leaving the Timbersaw alone, making an aggressive move into the enemy jungle, but now forced back the stun onto Ake, the Enchantress, forced to retreat. No-Tail, another stun. Beautiful from Ake. And that will be No-Tail now stunning himself. And there's our in-game audio.
That was a really good stun from Ake there.
And they're going Roche. Ward trap. There we go. You mentioned it. But this will be contested. Or at least Fnatic wants to contest.
It's a little obvious, I'd say. From Alliance, usually you want to smoke in there when they have no idea where S4 is going to be.
Or ideally like catch them when they rotate top, but they just charge straight into the
also
pit.
Also, Fly uses Terror on Roshan too instead of just getting Vision with it over here.
Here comes that Alk stun. He unloads on Ake. Doesn't have a heal. No mana available. Now the Chakram coming through. Remember, they don't have wards in the fight. They're only in the pit. No tail. Dropping fast. He drops Acid Spray, but that may just help Alliance kill off this Rosh. S4, he's going to claim it. No, he goes down. I think Aegis hits the deck there.
Hani got it.
Hani ends up walking in. Grand Theft Aegis. EGM will come back, however, and it's really chaotic at this point. Fly's going to fall. Three now dead. Hani, he took the Aegis, but at what cost? Tries to run. Can't run. He'll go down. A lot of deaths. A lot of blood was spilt this day just to steal that Aegis.
That was...
And who got the Rosh kill there? Did you see?
Dire got the Rosh kill.
Okay. So Dire gets the Rosh kill. Fnatic steals the Aegis, but promptly loses it. And in the end, I believe they lost three there.
Mm-hmm.
3-4-1?
There was a buyback?
Or 3-4-2?
I'm not exactly sure. There were a lot of deaths. There was a lot of action there.
Yeah.
it was really hard to tell.
This is where a team fight recap be handy. But, well, here Alliance going to rotate through the enemy jungle. Maybe looking to put some pressure on this bottom tower. And still, we have not seen a tower fall yet this game, Erlini. Great early pushing heroes. The Venge is decent. The Invoker's really strong. And, of course, a lot of these lines here are good at pushing, especially Enchantress and Shadow Shaman. But as of yet, no towers have fallen.
Alliance is actually ahead in gold, even though they're behind by 3 kills after that Roshan engagement. And that was just... I mean, Fnatic knew exactly what they were up to, but they couldn't stop it because Alliance wasn't actually low at all because Roshan isn't doing any damage.
S4, my friend. Not again. He gets off the wards. Now the Wisp comes. The turnaround's here. Alliance, they get one. They will lose S4. Yes, the Fort Spirit barely claims his life. But Hani, out of invokes here for quite some time. Loda just going to man mode on him. Slaps him down. 2-1.
That Orb of Venom doing a lot of work, though.
You may think you know how to deal with Wisp, but you never really do.
Era.
When the time comes. Yeah, Dark Pack's about to end here, but the Alk's done, connecting on 2 along with the Acid Spray. Alliance low, but not dead yet, and Bulldog diving. Dark Pact does not remove Viper Strike anymore, actually, and No-Tail might be the one to pay here with his own life, as we will see the Slark barely able to live. Shadow dances and gets away.
The game has completely changed now that Alliance has level 6.
This was 6-1, and now it's 10-9.
Yeah, well, once they got level 6 on Rasta, as well as Wisp, they just
And the Courier
so
actually,
much work.
Who's Radiant Courier just went down. Had a point booster on it as well. Big kill. I did not see how that died. Meanwhile, bottom lane, EGM getting caught out of position here, but Tether's away to safety. One more leap should be enough to bring him down. Tether now cooling down, and the leap's there. The pounce will latch him. He will fall. But Alliance still getting the better trades here overall after a pretty horrific start. The tower kill is a great relocate to turn that top fight around, as well as the Rosh fight actually working out very well for them.
Everyone's going tank builds on the side of Alliance. We see a Treads build up from EO. We see Viper also going Treads, and we see Shadow Shaman going Treads too. So they're just looking to tank up and survive the initial Unsacred Concoction and eventual Spirit Ganks. Fly is actually really hurting on levels, as well as No-Tail. level 4 and 5 respectively, and compare that to the Wisp, who's level 7.5, even after that most recent death.
You know, Merlini, I think the thing that, like, probably the biggest tie turner as well is that Bulldog has this mech now, and you look at Fnatic, they're not even close to a teamfight item like a mech. Invoker's actually going for an Orchid early on from Hani.
Yeah, he likes that build a lot.
Do you think it's good this game?
It's okay. I'd say he needs a little bit more move speed so he doesn't get caught out by EO or Viper or Lifesteal. Like, if he gets slowed attack once by Viper, he's going to die in a fight.
Force Staff is a really popular choice against Lifestealer and Viper, but we're not going to see it here. There is a relocate available if they needed to get Loda out of trouble, but he'll be okay. Meanwhile, Ake smoked up, heading towards the top rune, but now backs off, heads towards mid. As Alliance prepares for an aggressive dive. Fnatic are pretty ready for this, though. They're going to unload with another Unstable Concoction. It goes on the Loda once again. He didn't get off his Rage. It was cooling down. Now they Cold Snap him. He has Rage available, and in comes a parade of infantry. One falls. Now they latch on to Hani. They're going to pull him in, pop back out. Infest is there. Alliance secure 3 kills and just storm forward. Fnatic collapsing after an amazing start. Just not able to keep up the pace.
Trixie needed to be there for the fight. They need him as a front line. Sark doesn't have enough items right now. Alchemist isn't level 6 yet. Invoker doesn't have any survivability either. And they have to have him up there.
And not having that point booster really hurts him in this game. I mean, that's a big value item to pick up early on.
Is that even his?
Yeah, his point booster was the one that died, I believe. I believe it was his. Yeah, it's still on the dead courier. As they're going S4 here, and they should be able to get the kill. But they might pay for it. Loda jumps in, looking for No-Tail, slapping and chopping. No-Tail tanky, but not tanky. And a 50 HP regen ain't nothing for me, he says. Trixie will fall. Potentially could be the next in line. Bulldog, mech available. Could pop it. Not doing so yet. There's a tether. There was a relocate out, but doesn't get it off in time. Now EGM, he'll TP out. Is there a stun? There's a leap. There's a tornado. He's going to fall as well. Turn of the tides. 14-13.
Fnatic EGM was tethering him, and he thought that I thought that he was going to mech right as soon as he tethered, and then he would have gotten like a burst,
the double
like
heal.
500 heal.
And they also could have relocated him out, but they didn't try to do that either. If they had done the burst heal and then relocate, I think he would have lived for sure.
Alliance has taken the map by storm, though, and now that Roshan is going to respawn
look
in a couple
this.
Minutes.
I mean, they see like everything. These wards are amazing. Now, I know Alliance was talking about how they, you know, in the pregame interviews, the press conference, they said they felt like they don't like the change to smoke because it kind of punishes. Teams used to be rewarded for really good sentries and anticipating smoke ganks. Now they're not, but we could still see the power of those good aggressive observer wards really giving them the map control.
They need Slark to deward them. Slark actually has pretty much been a non-factor, I'd say, in this game. There's like so much damage going around that he can't really stay in the fight and do that much damage and steal that much from Essence Shift. Like, he's usually decent versus Lifestealer, but it doesn't seem like he's having effect at all in this game. Loda's actually pretty farmed too. He has a Drums, a Sage, and a Phase Boost already.
Quite
so 5-1-4, yeah.
Nobody CSing much though this game. The max CS is like 4 CS a minute. It's all about kills. 8-3-1 on the Invoker, 5-1-4 on the Lifestealer. It's really been a bloodbath. 27 kills, only 14 and a half minutes.
I mean, he has 8 kills, but he doesn't even have his Orchid yet. 14 minutes in.
I'm loving this style of play from these teams. You know, you look at Fnatic Alliance and you go back 4 or 5
months.
Oh,
there it is.
This could have been a pure Rat Dota game. You know, just Bulldog Prophet, Bulldog on Druid, you know, Loda on a Phantom Lancer. But the times have changed, Merlini.
Wisp equals kills.
It most certainly does. A lot of these heroes just like to fight early and often, especially on Fnatic's side. But after a lot of early engagements, they've been lacking opportunities to fight, and now they smoke is 5, but look what a kind of like an obvious smoke it is. The middle lane, bottom lane, and top lane all pushing in. They're going to try to make up for how obvious it is by just going outrageously deep into enemy territory, possibly diving past the tier 1, but if they dive here, they're going on to 5 heroes who could well be ready. Do they just backdoor the tier 1? Is that the choice? Yes, it is, and Loda, he'll just TP out. Well, they force out a glyph. They might get a tier 1, but it's something.
They're losing out on farm all 3 lanes, though.
Yeah, and this tower will be there later.
Yeah, I don't think it's worth it for them.
It almost feels, I wouldn't say a desperation move, but like they're really digging deep to be doing that.
Alliance, I think, saw that coming, too. They pinged out over here, and now they might get a T2 in exchange.
And they will. They'll look to, anyway. S4 dropping the Serpent Wards, as we'll see a TP come in from Trixie. But he'll back off, and, well, these will be some extra much-needed gold for Fnatic here. Ward's not particularly effective against Timbersaw. He will get zapped up, though. Now the relocate comes. They're going to dive him. Trixie gets swapped out. Nice job by Fly, keeping him alive. Good damage from the Evoker, but not enough to get a kill. Now Era jumps in. They bring down one. The Courier joining the party as well. Era now latched up. Can't escape. Three down. Only the Wisp to trade. And once again, Alliance on the winning end of that trade. No Tail on the back foot. It'll be a 4-for-1. They're just getting overwhelmed. Alliance storming forth. 17-16, but it feels like a lot more. Well,
they have no solution for a Lifestealer. Like, usually the Miner's Armor is okay, but when he's this big relative to Fnatic, it's just not enough.
And the other thing is the early mech on Viper and having Wisp make this Lifestealer way harder to kill.
Yeah, and having Wisp have a lot of levels, too. Like, EGM is almost level 9 at this point, too.
Yeah, already 2 points in overcharge and more to come. This Lifestealer, deceptively tanky. And, I mean, on paper, he looks tanky, but he's even tankier than that. And same will soon be the case for Bulldog, building towards an Aghanim Scepter and not far off of it. You give an Aghanim Scepter to Viper at, like, the 22 to 25-minute mark, that's going to be big trouble for Fnatic.
Yeah, and you give Lifestealer an Aegis too, and I don't think they're going to be able to kill him once, let alone twice.
Now the four staff coming out. S4 just getting kind of a nice counter-initiation item for his team, and also four staff into Hex. It's not quite a blink, but just a more versatile pickup from him. And now Alliance, a lot of ways to start fights. The four staff into Hex, relocate. Bulldog can just charge in and soak up damage, so too can Lota. And you could just see from the way Fnatic are playing, they're really bottled up here, Merlini. And so the question becomes, if you're Fnatic, how do you break this contain? How do you get out of this, like, being on the back foot position that they've been stuck in?
They had, like, okay late game as far as their lineup goes, but when Slark is just under farm, you can't play the farm more against a Lifestealer.
There's no Invoker Midas. Yeah. Trixie went mech. He didn't go straight Bloodstone. So they didn't really go for, like, the ultra-greedy farm build.
They can't play the farm game. What they need to do is contest the next Roshan. If they get with the next Roshan to Lifestealer, Lifestealer is going to be way too big for them to deal with. And Orchid is okay, but it just came out a little bit too late. And
I feel like this is a game where, like, normally maybe you can silence the Lifestealer and just focus him down, but when he's backed up by Wisp and mech, it's just not going to happen. So it's just not working out. Well, now the mech comes out, but for Fnatic, it's an 18-minute mech on Trixie. Because he went for this Arcane Boots point booster, then he didn't get to use the point booster because the Courier got sniped. And, well, he finally is the mech now. Normally a tide turning item. Could still be important versus Alliance. They do a lot of damage over time here, especially from the Viper. So keeping your HP up means less Nether Toxin damage, but not going to help you as much against the Lifestealer.
Yep, Aki doing some scout work right now because Fnatic has burned through so many smokes. Alchemist, as good as a start as he had, only has Brown Boost Medallion, a Magic Stick, and a TP Scroll, and that's it.
Normally when a team with an Alchemist gets ahead early, they can just transition into, like, a farm game. Stack the jungle, he focuses, like, gets, like, 1 point Grievous Greed, just gets level 9, and, you know, he doesn't AFK farm, but he gets up some core items for the team. Instead, it's like Trixie has kind of been forced into that position of getting the mech, when you'd ideally love for the Alchemist to have it. And Fnatic, at this point, a lot of heroes that need farming levels. Venge, you really want to hit 11. That's not coming anytime soon. The Alk doesn't even have stun or... doesn't have Acid Spray maxed and wants to have some more tank items. Because sure, he's got all this HP regen, but he's still very squishy.
They also weren't able to translate any kills into tower kills early. The only tower kill they got was from the 5-man smoke. Now Roshan's up. S4 is doing it again. And... I mean, do you think this Shadow Shaman Roche War Tret is broken enough to be patched out?
Yeah. Well, I just think it's stupid. You know, like, it should be in the game.
Right.
Whether it's broken or not, it's...
I don't really think it was that big of a game changer. The first time that we saw Alliance, like, get the gold lead was exactly when that Roshan fight happened. So I guess it put Fnatic in a really bad situation where they just didn't want to give them a free Aegis.
Yeah.
So...
I wouldn't necessarily say it's broken, because Shadow Shaman brings a lot of other issues to the table as well.
Right.
Like, sure, you can pick Ursa. He's great at killing Roche, but that doesn't mean he's broken, right? Shadow Shaman great at killing Roche, but comes with a lot of downsides and got completely shut down early. I feel like the Shadow Shaman could have been a huge liability this game, as we do unpause and hop back into it, guys. But Alliance just had a few clutch fights, and that really made the difference.
Yeah, they really did. I think that EGM has been playing extremely well, too.
Yeah, this Wisp play has been, it's been just every bit as good as No Tails, as we will see a relocate onto the bottom lane. They go for Trixie, the four-step Hex finds him. Trixie dead to rights. He's got a mech here, but ain't getting out of this one.
Yeah, he's been involved in 16 of 18
kills.
Oh, they
can go back and kill Hani. Hani's sticking around.
Nope.
Just EGM. Interesting. I thought he would bring him back and go for this kill, but maybe thinking Hani's got backup and decides to play it safe.
And now that Loda, or sorry, who has the Aegis? S4 actually has the Aegis. Now that they have the Aegis, they can definitely take another fight. They're looking to just starve Fnatic out right now. One T2 tower down already, looking for another two. Era is just really poor. Forced to go to Drum's build too because he needs a little bit more HP.
Unfortunately, a little more HP against a lot of damage from Lifestealer and Viper, not going to end in your favor, it feels.
They don't have the burst for Lifestealer, though.
They don't have the burst for him. They don't have the reliable lockdown that goes through BKB. We mentioned they have the Rage, but we mentioned they have the damage, but that's where it ends. And now the wards come out. And with S4 having Aegis, don't be surprised to see a 4-staff Hex even into the enemy base. He can get one kill, die, come back, and do it all over again. But for now, it's a set of wards for a tier 2, a trade they'll be happy to make if Hani going for the trade. And he may get a tier 2 or at least bring it low. Nope, not even going to get that. Alliance taking and giving nothing back. And will we see a relocate here? It is available in 1 second's time.
I'm actually not sure why Fly did not max his stun. He went for a 3 terror build. It's okay, I suppose. I think maybe if they had like a Shadow Fiend instead of Invoker, it'd be better. But with the three wave of terror, like, you use your stun a lot, and that stun is just so important at being able to burst people down. 100 to 325 damage is a very, very big difference.
Yeah, and if Alliance don't get bursted, they win the fight. Because right. Lifestealer gets stronger as the fights go on.
They get relocated out, yeah. They want to heal.
They mech, they tether and run away and come back in when Rage is off cooldown. They infest and pop back out. You need the burst. But at this point, I don't know if it would be enough anyway. Mm-hmm. To be honest, like, Lotus sitting on,
it might have led to better early mid engagements, though.
That's true. At this point, it may be too late for Fnatic. The hour is late for game one, but it is a best of three. No matter what happens,
yeah. I thought Fnatic was going to get wrecked, was going to wreck Alliance with his draft, but
and
I
the
mean,
way the
Alliance
game developed,
Alliance is playing extremely well.
This is just pure comeback Dota, selecting good fights. And I mean, the one thing about the Shadow Shaman wards in the Roshan pit is it did force Fnatic into a very uncomfortable position. They had to dive past Roche just to snatch the Aegis. They got trapped in the pit. The wards did a little bit of damage to them during that time, and sure, they stole the Aegis, but Alliance got that gold, and the gold is really adding up for them now. They have a blink on S4. They could look to leap. He'll blink. He'll stun. He'll drop the wards as well. Hani on the run. No tail dropping fast. He'll take a fall. And now Trixie on the backside trying to retreat. Will he be able to survive? It doesn't look like it. Loda and Bulldog still at half HP. There's a hold on Bulldog. This Viper just ain't going to die. And this is looking worse and worse for Team Fnatic here. Loda, Alliance, they'll take down the tier 2.
They can't even kill Aki.
They got S4, but, I mean, a job well done. He can die after he's done that.
They've taken down all the T2s already, yeah.
Systematic Dota from Alliance. If you give this team a lead, probably one of the best teams in Dota at protecting that lead.
And now Fnatic has no map control. They're all huddled inside our T3 right now. They cannot escape their base because they're scared to relocate ganks. And I'm surprised he didn't actually relocate S4 out. But going for long shot right now, Loda doing the Ancients while he senses something is up and TP's out before they even get there.
EGM, enter Godmo with these spidey senses. Just right when he needs to run, he's going to. Did I jinx him? I jinxed him early, and he's going to get caught out now, and he will go down.
It was also a 6-second TP. I think if it was a 3, he might have been able to get away.
I feel bad. Sorry, EGM. That was my bad. Blitz is probably very mad at Reem right now, but for the time being, Fnatic, they'll try and transition that kill into a tower push, and this is only going to be their second tower of the game. The tier 1 falls mid. Fnatic showing a small pulse here, a small sign of life. But they need a lot more than that. They're still down over 15k, 10k experience, and just key items for Alliance. I mean, better initiation. For now, better team fight. But like you mentioned, Merlini, if Fnatic gets their feedback in this game, their lineup goes quite late.
Fnatic can't ever get a jump on Alliance, though. That's the thing. Like, Alliance's positioning has been really good. Their map awareness has been really good. And their heroes just lend to
don't
not
die.
Getting initiated on.
And, like, if you catch Bulldog, you're not killing him before he gets to use mech and before the Wisp shows up, most likely.
I mean, he has a hood, too.
Pipe is coming for him. And Fnatic, with the Invoker kind of and Timbersaw being the two main damage dealers, Slark doesn't have much at this point. Pipe is going to be really strong this game.
Pipe's exceptionally strong. I'm not really sure why it's not built more often. I think it's a really, really cost-efficient item, and it's really good for pushing up to T3. But yeah, Bulldog is extremely difficult to kill. If you go on Lota, you're going to lose a fight too, especially with him having AC at this point. You can kill S4. They really need to kill S4 early on in the fights, I think, before he drops his wards, if possible.
After just getting completely shut down mid and Fnatic putting so much pressure on him, his initiations have been picture perfect. I don't think he's gotten caught out once at the start of a fight this game.
And yeah, he's died 8 times, but usually they're for good reasons.
S4, I mean, very different from, you know, some other solo mids. Like, you look at especially like Mushi or even Denny, more like Snowball type solos. But S4, just, you know, one of the very...
He's a controller.
Composed controller, exactly. Like, kind of like a Shao 8 style of solo mid, and really showcasing his resilience here after an awful start. It's almost like he didn't even lose mid. And they're diving bottom right now.
It really is.
There's your Viper strike on Ahani. Force staff comes in, and they don't really need to force this. Just drop the wards, go to work on the tower. The stun comes out on Lota. The leap will miss, and now Eric could be in a bad spot here. Lota dropping fast. Can he get bailed out? No bailout. Lota's dead, and Alliance must run. No relocate out.
I'm surprised he died there.
The mech and Piper used, but they were able to focus him down.
Yeah, and overcharge, I believe. Yeah, I'm very surprised that he died there.
The only thing they could have done was relocate him out, but I feel like they felt they could take the fight and just weren't able to. Now they could lose Bulldog as well. Is this a turnaround? Once again, nope. Big bailout from EGM! Oy, oy, oy. What a player.
Is he going to be able to escape? That's a question.
They're trying to tether him out here, but I don't think
he has a Ghost Scepter. I think he may be...
Cold Snap? Yep.
He's okay. Never mind. No chance.
Orchid makes it an easy kill.
It's worth it, though.
Fantastic Wisp play. And no tail, he likes some Jerry.
Yeah, S4, they still almost got the tower on bottom, even though they lost that fight for sure. The kill score is even right now. Alliance, they have definite control of the map right now, and if they take out the next Roshan, it's almost certainly going to lead to a Rax. So Fnatic cannot let that happen. They need to keep the Four Spirits up for scouting, need to have just good map awareness to prevent this from happening.
Yeah, meanwhile, Fnatic, they will move back through their own jungle and try to farm towards some key items at this point, which are feeling very late. I imagine we'll still see Trixie go for the Bloodstone, but it's almost so late, like, it's not even worth getting it anymore. I guess could go Shiva's here. Hani getting a Hex would be really big for this team. Arrow will work towards an Eye of Scotty, but these key items, the only one they're really close to is maybe the Hex on Hani, but still, like, almost 2,000 gold away.
Slark might also be going for Lincoln's.
Do you think? There's a lot of ways.
Scotty, I think, is better. But
there's quite a few ways to break it this game. Open wounds, Enchantress slow, two ways from Shadow. Three ways from Shadow.
He can't get Hex, though. If he gets Hex, he's going to die. The Blink Hex initiation from Shadow Chum is really strong.
You can Aether Shock and then Hex, but it is a slight bit slower.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have to see what Eric goes for, but either way, he's got to farm it. He's not there yet.
Yeah, he's not going to have enough. I don't think either item is going to really save him at this point.
So basically at this point, Fnatic are going to play the waiting game. They'll look for some key items. As for Alliance, still have room to scale, still go pretty late, but ideally with the Ags just complete on the Enchantress, Lota being really fat, they'd like to use this next Aegis and at least siege the base, if not take Rax. So look for Alliance to continue to be the aggressors and the ones really forcing the fights head on. Fnatic looking to be a little bit more sneaky and surreptitious about their ganks. Find the pickoffs. We'll see if they can do it.
Fnatic just needs to wait for Alliance to make more mistakes. So if they make another mistake like that where Lifestealer just dies at the start of the fight without exchanging it for anything, then yeah, Fnatic can't come back. But aside from that, it's really in Alliance's hands.
The tier 2 will fall, and obviously Fnatic has to be somewhat worried about a Roche. Not scouting it yet, and considering a push here, it's a tier 2 for a Roche. That will be the trade, it appears. And to be honest, given their position, not a bad trade.
It's the Aegis and the Cheese.
That is true. Not a great trade, but
not a great trade.
I feel contesting it would be very difficult because the chances of them ambushing Alliance in the pit are way lower than ambushing them just out in the field on the map.
Yeah, but in the pit without Aegis Cheese as opposed to at the T3 with Aegis Cheese.
And wards getting dropped. The same. It's pretty bad either way.
This tower's really low too. It's at 210 HP. It's almost certainly going to drop. They have a glyph, but you're not going to be able to kill the Rasta wards fast enough.
And obviously this is the point in the game where buybacks could really turn it around for Fnatic. If Alliance overextends, sure, they've got Aegis Cheese. You have some buybacks on your side, and they right now have one on Hani as well as Trixie, two of their key heroes. But if they save for buyback, that means they don't have the Hex, the Lincoln's components. He'll only be sitting, or the Scotty components will only be sitting on the one ultimate orb. And here comes the push. Fnatic, if they want to glyph, have to do it early. Chakram comes out. Timbersaw trying to slow it down, but Lotus says, screw that. I'm going deep.
He also orchided a creep.
That's going to hurt. I mean, even if he didn't, though, this is going to be a hard fight. The stun comes through on Lota. He will be disabled for now, but he gets mech'd. He gets piped. He's still at half HP, and Fest pop back out. They're going straight for the racks. Definitely Blast is here. Alliance, just a calm and steady siege. Fly now slowed. Hard to engage. Hard to wait. Alliance really out of options here, perhaps. Bologi gets silenced, but they can't bring him down. Assess forward. The great counter initiation. They get one low. The buyback comes immediately from the Slark. Tornado now. The one buyback is there, but three have fallen. It's just overwhelming force from Alliance. They're dominating Fnatic here. Another Blink. Another Hex. Throw the imps. Jam it in. Era. Not going to fall, though. He'll leap away to safety. But this will be a Rex for Alliance, and they have lost nothing for it. Not even the cheese.
Just can't get a good initiation, though. Like, they jump Viper. Viper is super tanky. You don't want to go on him. They try to kill Lifestealer early on in the fight, but he backs off, and he has his Aegis. And if you do that, S4 is just going to get the perfect initiation. He got the Hex off on Hera, and...
His positioning was great in that fight. Just sat really far back, said, when they jump, I'll just counter-initiate. Didn't force the fight, because this time he didn't have Aegis, so this time he doesn't want to be the one jumping in first. He's really come back nicely this game.
Fnatic has to come to them, too, because the wards are beaten down on their base.
That's the wards are... It's very similar to having a Pugna, where he just keeps on walking up, blasts the tower back off. You can't just sit there. Eventually your tower will fall. Same thing here with the wards.
It forces the opponents to make bad decisions.
And in this case, they don't have the firepower. They just don't have enough damage. Don't have enough lockdown. They need everything at this point. And in that fight, the one here they did not lose was Hani. So now he's got Scythe, and I don't think saving for buyback is going to change this game. They need more items on Fnatic.
Yeah, I think he should go for a Scythe too. Alliance, they should probably try and take another Rex before the Aegis expires.
And they've got a good amount of time to do it. Looks like about 3 minutes to go before the Aegis will expire. Quite a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll go back to farming here. New items coming out soon for Alliance. Lota working towards the Abyssal Blade. We may see the Mask of Madness next for Ake if he wants to build it. And Enchantress can be the secret weapon in these teamfights. It does scale very, very, very high, effectively into the late game. Even a Scythe now, or Lincoln's perhaps, coming out for S4 next. Either or would be great. Wisp, just the basics. Sanj, Heaven's Halberd, probably going to be the choice there. And, well, your Viper's got a Yasha. Mansa next. Alliance just making, I think, like the perfect item selections for this game. Tanky items, good pushing items, good utility items to counter the burst damage and initiation. They survive the burst and they win the fight. That's been the story of the past 10, 15 minutes.
Hani is decently high on the net worth chart, so at number 3 right now at 15,000. I think the big loser here is Era on the Slark. He's behind the Timbersaw. He's just barely ahead of EGM's Wisp.
And now Alliance, they march fourth in the top lane. It's game one of a best of three, and it could be a 1-0 lead for Alliance. It certainly feels that way. Leading by 17k gold, marching onto the high ground. The creeps are pushing towards the bottom lane. There's no glyph here, and Hani now caught out. He's got a sight. The ward's getting dropped, and still tanky. No tail with Ghost Scepter. Dodging, stalling, baiting out the rage. But while that was happening, the bench did fall. Now Trixie on the run, and Alliance just crushing through. Fnatic, there's too much damage here. They're just too tanky. Hani can't stand against it. In come the imps. He'll go down. And now they go for more. They want Trixie. They want the world. And they might get it. Trixie barely able to live. And No Tail will be the price to be paid here. 20-26, your score. But Fnatic, this was not close after the 15-20 minute mark.
Yeah, that was just brutal. S4, I was A's MVP this game. Maybe Lota too. I don't know. I think all of Alliance played really well, though. It's really difficult to take the game that commandingly after you get behind that far early.
GG! Alliance showing some real backbone here at Star Ladder Season 8, the LAN Finals. And there's a lot of money on the line. They had a great showing in the D2CL against Speed Gaming. And they're looking calm and collected here. I was worried about their mentality coming to this game. I think you were a little bit as well.
Calm and collected.
Yeah, collected. This is just Alliance. They're just relaxed. They're Swedes. They don't show their emotions.
They don't even look like they won a game.
Well, you'll know when No-Tail's winning because we'll be able to hear him from, like, he's like 100 meters away from us. We'll still hear him yelling.
I guess in retrospect, it was a good draft. I didn't see it coming, but
I feel like Fnatic took a lot of bad fights as well, though, after they got that early lead.
Which ones?
Like the Roche fight,
they you have to take it, though, I think.
But do they have to take it so aggressively? Like, they had, like, four heroes charging into the pit.
They were, like, there as soon as the Roshan started, so they definitely knew what was going on. They had like a 20 to 30-second window, I suppose. Like, usually you can delay with Chakram, but they were just not able to do it. That was, like, the big turning point of the game, though.
The Roche fight definitely turned the tides. And, you know, the funny, they stole the Aegis. It looked like a decent fight for them, but ended up, Alliance got the Roche kill, which I think made a big difference.
I think the buyback from S4.
And the other key thing that you mentioned was that Alliance transitioned from kills into towers. And we never saw that from Fnatic. When they were taking towers, it's like they smoke ganked to tier one and missed like four, like two waves of creeps in three lanes to do it.
They also didn't get enough experience.
Revenge and Alchemist, very level dependent heroes. They didn't have a Midas on Invoker either.
They needed
a
swap early, like way early on, but they weren't able to get it.
And by the mid-game, level one swap just doesn't cut it. They didn't have a great initiation.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the other key thing was the Wisp. The EGM's Wisp was just spectacular.
It was really good.
And it's where you might know how to play against Wisp, but you can only react so fast as a human when like you're being attacked from one side, and then all of a sudden Wisp relocates on top of you. You can't prepare for everything, Marlini.
I know. And Loda managed to find a ton of farm, too, even after rotating mid to help out S4, which he didn't even get a kill out of it.
Well, Alliance, they've taken home a Star Ladder before. Can they do it again? We're going to find out soon, but for now, they lead 1-0 in the best of three.
So what does Fnatic do in the second game? Ban Wisp?
Because
Alliance first picked Wisp and gave up an Alchemist.
And Timbersaw, who's very strong in this patch as well.
I would definitely say that Alliance lost the draft there, but they still won. So
so you can't say they lost the draft.
So they can't,
Maybe they didn't win the draft. I think I still feel like they just outplayed Fnatic.
They outplayed them really
hard. A lot of it was just having heroes that are... I think the other key thing was they had the Wisp, and they also had the early mech from Bulldog. And you look at what Trixie had. He had a Point Booster and Arcane Boots. The Point Booster was on the Courier.
Yeah, if he went Arcane Mech, I think...
Might have had it by that team fight. All the Courier might have died.
Slark
delivered.
Had no items either. Slark was picked way too early, and it just... He's not that good versus Wisp and...
Who was it who was saying he's overrated? Was it fucking Matt earlier?
Yes.
Yeah, and Miguel was telling us he was singing his praises.
He's okay versus he's situational. But
he's a good 1v1 hero in certain matchups.
Yeah.
But he didn't get a great matchup.
He didn't do anything.
And, I mean, Eret did make some mistakes. Like, you mentioned using
Leaf pounce
offensively. Yeah. That hurt them a lot as well. Just that early death gave a lot of experience to Alliance, who were offensive dual lane on the Dire. You don't get that much experience there.
They created so much room for an Invoker, though. Like, I talked about before how the mid matchup was important, but S4 got dominated in mid by the supports, yet he still made a huge impact compared to what Hani did. And I think that's what makes a really good mid player. One that you can just make impact even when you're not given the opportunity to, really.
Yeah, with that being said, player of the game, who would you give it to?
I think
I think EGM or S4 for me.
Yeah, I would say EGM S4. Admiral, I mean...
It's funny because you look at S4, he's topping the death charts. He had a bad game, but his possession was great after the late.
Admiral Bulldog was 9-3 and 9-2, but I mean, Viper's just Viper. You can't really do like anything spectacular, I guess.
He Viper striked really well in that fight. Perfect usage of Viper strike.
He used his Corrosive Skin really well by taking damage.
Yeah. And, well, with that being said, any closing thoughts on game two before we go to a break here? Or game one, rather?
I'm trying to think about what Fnatic can do better for next game. What everyone's trying to figure out.
I think it's like, first of all, like I'd like to see them have something that can push a little bit better after they get those kills.
Invoker's supposed to be decent.
Yeah, but that was it. Like Timbersaw is not going to kill towers quickly, and neither is... I think the Slark was the big mistake, if you could say, of the draft, perhaps.
Yes, I would say so, too.
Well, we'll have to see what they go for.
Do they get Wisp and get Alchemist?
If they get Wisp Tiny, like they'll be golden. So they're going to have first pick this game, I believe.
I think Alliance is just going to ban Wisp, though.
Yeah. If you're Alliance, you just ban Wisp here.
Yeah.
You don't give that away to Fnatic. If they do, though, Pride cometh before the fall, and we'll go to a game.
Well, I want to see another action-packed game, so I'm hoping that they don't ban Wisp.
Well, we'll find out soon, guys. We're live here at Star Ladder Season 8 in Kiev. We're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, we'll be live with Game 2, currently Alliance leading 1-0.